Say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, that was all about earth sciences. We shall now have on the dais experts from the life sciences field. For this, I invite a pair. Don't get me wrong, they aren't twins. They are Mr. Kamran Qureshi, the botanist from London, and Mr. Asad Bukhari, the zoologist from Bloomington. As a pair, they are actively involved in Dawah activities through the London Dawah Organization. Welcome, brothers. We also warmly welcome Brother Zaid Sayyid, an embryologist from Africa. He was highly inspired by the findings of Professor Keith Moore. Brother Zaid wishes to confirm all the facts in the Quran and wishes to be a hafiz in the near future. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he fulfills your endeavors and accepts his efforts. Ameen. I also warmly welcome Mr. Hamza Ali, the forensic expert, pursuing a PhD in criminal justice, and he also conducts research and provides education in cybersecurity and forensic research. Mr. Hamza Ali, I'm eagerly waiting to know what the Quran has to say about forensic science.
Jazakallah khair, brother. That was indeed an apt introduction. There is not a single living thing on the face of this earth that has not been created by Lord in pairs. Previously, humans did not know that plants do have male and female gender distinctions. Botany states that every plant has a male and female gender. As the Quran states in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 53. وَأَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِنْ نَبَاتٍ شَتَّى. And has sent down water from the sky. With it have we produced diverse pairs of plants, each separate from the others.
Is everything made in pairs?
Oh yes, of course. The Quran states in Surah Az-Zariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 49. وَمِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَا زَوْجَيْنِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. The Quran states that of everything we have created in pairs, that you may perhaps remember. This verse lays emphasis on everything. Besides humans, animals, plants and fruits, it may also be referring to electricity, in which the atoms consist of negatively and positively charged electrons and protons, and many more things.
Subhanallah, the Quran is indeed an eye-opener for all of us.
It is not only the Quran that it speaks about pairs, but what is surprising is that the Quran also speaks about animals and birds living in communities. It is mentioned in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 38. There is not an animal on this earth, nor a being that flies on its wings, except that it forms a community like you. Research has shown that animals and birds live in communities. That is, they organize, work and live together.
I can only admire the ability of the birds soaring up in the skies.
I agree with you. The verse also touches on birds. It is mentioned in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 19. Do they not observe the birds above them, spreading their wings and folding them in? Nothing opposes them except Allah, the most gracious. Truly, it is He that is watching over all things. The Arabic word amsaka literally means to put one's hand on, to hold, to seize, or to hold someone back, which expresses the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds the birds up in His power. Professor Hamburger, in his book, Power and Fragility, gives the example of the mutton bird, which lives in the Pacific, with its journey over 24,000 kilometers in the shape of figure 8. It completes this journey within 6 months and returns to its departure point with the maximum delay of 1 week. The highly complicated instructions for such a journey have to be contained in the bird's nerve cells. This is definitely programmed. So therefore, should we not even reflect on the identity of this programmer?
That is a question we all should ponder about. You have enlightened us with true knowledge. The Quran and modern science are indeed compatible.
It's not only the birds that the Quran speaks about. Tiny insects have also been mentioned. Take for example the bee and its gill. It is mentioned in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 to 69. And thy Lord taught the bee to build itself in hills, on trees, and in men's habitations, and to eat from all the produce of the earth, and to find with skill its spacious paths of its Lord. The bee, whenever it discovers a new garden or a flower, It goes back to its fellow bees and tells them the exact direction of the map to get there. This is called the bee dance. These insects' movements that are intended to transmit the information between worker bees have been scientifically discovered using photographs and many other methods. The above verses of the Quran show how the bee finds with skill its spacious path of its Lord.
Oh yes, Professor von Frisch had received the Nobel Prize Award in 1973 for his research on the bees' behavior and their communication. But what about the terrestrial insects?
Oh, how can we ignore them? The spider's web and its fragile home. It is mentioned in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 41. The parable of those who take protection other than Allah is that of the spider. It builds to itself a house, and truly, the flimsiest of houses is that of the spider, if they but knew. Besides giving the physical description of the spider's web as being very delicate, weak and flimsy, the Quran also stresses on the flimsiness of the relationship in the spider's house, where the female spider often kills its mate, the male spider.
And if I'm not wrong, Brother Asad, the parable also has references to weaknesses of such relationship of people who seek protection from those other than Allah for this world and for the hereafter.
Well said. The Quran also throws light on the sophistication in lifestyle and communication in ants. It is mentioned in Surah Naml, chapter number 27, verse number 17 to 18. And before Solomon marshaled his hosts of jinn, men and birds, and they were all ranged in ranks. At length, when they came to a lowly valley of ants, one of the ants said, "O ye ants, get into your dwellings before Solomon and his hosts crush you underfoot while they do not know." Our research has shown that animals and insects whose lifestyle is the closest in resemblance if the lifestyle of human beings is that of ants.
Are there any findings on this?
Yes, there are. Recent findings regarding ants show that ants bury their dead in the similar way the humans do. They have a sophisticated division of labor wherein they have managers, supervisors, foremen and workers, etc. Once a while, they meet among themselves to have a chat. They have an advanced method of communication among themselves. They hold regular markets wherein they exchange goods.
We'll take some time to get attuned to. Brother Asad, I have always wondered about the process of honey formation. Does the Quran have anything regarding this?
Yes, it has. Honey is the healing for humankind, and how can the Quran not mention about it? The bee assimilates juices of various kinds of flowers and forms honey within its body and stores it in cells of wax. Only a couple of centuries ago, humans came to know that honey comes from the belly of the bee. But this fact was mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. In the following verse of Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 69, "And there issues from within their bodies a drink of varying colors, wherein is healing for men."
That solves my query. I am also tempted to ask you about the process of milk formation.
Sure, brother. In simple terms, certain substances from the intestine enter into the vessels of the intestinal wall itself. And these substances are transported by the bloodstream to various organs. This physiological concept must be fully appreciated if we wish to understand the following verse from the Quran, from Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 66. "And indeed, in cattle, there is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from within the bodies, from a conjunction between the intestine and the blood, a milk pure and pleasant for those who drink it." The Quran also mentioned in another verse in the Quran, from Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21. "Indeed, in cattle, there is an instructive example. We give you to drink from within their bodies. Besides, there are numerous other benefits for you, and from their meat ye eat."
Milk reminds me of little babies and their shrills. How amazing is their creation.
Allahu Akbar, Allah, Allahu Akbar.
I can only admire the ability of the birds soaring up in the skies.
I agree with you. The verse also touches on birds. It is mentioned in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 19. "Do they not observe the birds above them, spreading their wings and folding them in? Nothing opposes them except Allah, the most gracious. Truly, it is He that is watching over all things." The Arabic word amsaka literally means to put one's hand on, to hold, to seize, or to hold someone back, which expresses the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds the birds up in his power. Professor Hamburger, in his book, Power and Fragility, gives the example of the mutton bird, which lives in the Pacific, with its journey over 24,000 kilometers in the shape of figure 8. It completes this journey within 6 months and returns to its departure point with the maximum delay of 1 week. The highly complicated instructions for such a journey have to be contained in the bird's nerve cells. This is definitely programmed. So therefore, should we not even reflect on the identity of this programmer?
That is a question we all should ponder about. You have enlightened us with true knowledge. The Quran and modern science are indeed compatible.
It's not only the birds that the Quran speaks about. Tiny insects have also been mentioned. Take, for example, the bee and its quill. It is mentioned in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 to 69. And thy Lord taught the bee to build itself in hills, on trees, and in men's habitations, and to eat from all the produce of the earth, and to find with skill its spacious parts of its Lord. The bee, whenever it discovers a new garden or a flower, it goes back to its fellow bees and tells them the exact direction or the map to get there. This is called the bee dance. These insect movements that are intended to transmit the information between worker bees have been scientifically discovered using photographs and many other methods. The above verse of the Quran show how the bee finds with skill its spacious parts of its Lord.
Oh yes, Professor Von Frisch had received the Nobel Prize Award in 1973 for his research on the bees' behavior and their communication. But what about the terrestrial insects?
Oh, how can we ignore them? The spider's web and its fragile home. It is mentioned in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 41. The parable of those who take protection other than Allah is that of the spider. It builds to itself a house, and truly, the flimsiest of houses is that of the spider, if they but knew. Besides giving the physical description of the spider's web as being very delicate, weak and flimsy, the Quran also stresses on the flimsiness of the relationship in the spider's house, where the female spider often kills its mate, the male spider.
And if I'm not wrong, Brother Asad, the parable also has references to weaknesses of such relationship of people who seek protection from those other than Allah for this world and for the hereafter.
Well said. The Quran also throws light on the sophistication in lifestyle and communication in ants. It is mentioned in Surah Naml, chapter number 27, verse number 17 to 18. And before Solomon marshaled his hosts of jinn, men and birds, and they were all ranged in ranks. At length, when they came to a lowly valley of ants, one of the ants said, O ye ants, get into your dwellings before Solomon and his hosts crush you underfoot while they do not know. Our research has shown that animals and insects whose lifestyle is the closest in resemblance if the lifestyle of human beings is that of ants.
Are there any findings on this?
Yes, yes, there are. Recent findings regarding ants show that ants bury their dead in the similar way the humans do. They have a sophisticated division of labor wherein they have managers, supervisors, foremen and workers, etc. Once a while, they meet among themselves to have a chat. They have an advanced method of communication among themselves. They hold regular markets wherein they exchange goods.
We'll take some time to get attuned to. Brother Asad, I have always wondered about the process of honey formation. Does the Quran have anything regarding this?
Yes, it has. Honey is the healing for humankind, and how can the Quran not mention about it? The bee assimilates juices of various kinds of flowers and forms honey within its body and stores it in cells of wax. Only a couple of centuries ago, humans came to know that honey comes from the belly of the bee. But this fact was mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. In the following verse of Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 69. And there issues from within their bodies a drink of varying colors, wherein is healing for men.
That solves my query. I am also tempted to ask you about the process of milk formation.
Sure, brother. In simple terms, certain substances from the intestine enter into the vessels of the intestinal wall itself. And these substances are transported by the bloodstream to various organs. This physiological concept must be fully appreciated if we wish to understand the following verse from the Quran, from Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 66. And indeed, in cattle, there is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from within the bodies, from a conjunction between the intestine and the blood, a milk pure and pleasant for those who drink it. The Quran also mentioned in another verse from Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21. Indeed, in cattle, there is an instructive example. We give you to drink from within their bodies. Besides, there are numerous other benefits for you. And from their meat, ye eat.
Milk reminds me of little babies and their shrills. How amazing is their creation.
Truly, brother, let me share a very interesting fact with you. All the information in the Quran and the undisputed hadith concerning embryology so gathered after being translated into English and then was presented to Professor Keith Moore. The professor of embryology and the chairman of the department at the University of Toronto in Canada. He was one of the person having the highest authority in the field of embryology and was asked to give his opinion on the facts on the material which was presented to him. After analyzing it completely and examining it very carefully, he came to a conclusion and said that all the information in the Quran and the undisputed hadith concerning embryology is in perfect conformity with the discoveries in the field of embryology. And the Arabic word alaq, besides meaning a congealed clot of blood, it also means a leech-like substance. Now, Professor Keith Moore didn't have any knowledge about this initial stage to be appearing like a leech. And to check this out, he studied this under a very powerful microscope. And then he compared the embryo that he had seen under the microscope with a diagrammatic leech. And he was very astonished at the striking resemblance between the two.
I can only visualize the shock on Professor Keith Moore's face. He would have been astonished with the discovery.
Furthermore, Allah Al-Hafiz, the protector of the fetus, he protects the fetus by three veils of darkness. It is very clearly mentioned in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter 39, verse number 6, he says, he makes you in the wombs of your mother, in stages after one another, by three veils of darkness. Now, Professor Keith Moore refers to these three veils of darkness as the following three things. He refers to the first one as the anterior abdominal wall, and the second as the uterine wall, and the third and the last one as the amniocryonic membrane. Furthermore, to just add on, I would like to mention that Quran too mentions about the embryonic stages, as it is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 12 to 14. He says, man, we did create from a quintessence of clay, and then we placed him as a drop of sperm in a place of rest, firmly fixed. And out of that sperm, we made a congealed clot of blood. And out of that clot, we made a fetus lump. And out of that fetus lump, we made bones. And then we clothed those bones with flesh. And after that, entirely, we developed a new creature. So blessed be Allah, the best to create. So as you can see, in this verse, it's very clearly mentioning that man has been created from a very small quantity of liquid, which is placed in a place of rest, firmly fixed and well established.
Subhanallah, feel very blessed.
And brothers, you know, when we are still in our mother's womb, we can hear. How amazing is that? Is it? You know, the first sense to be developed in the developing human embryo is the sense of hearing. The fetus can hear the sound after the 24th week. Subsequently, and about the sense of sight, it's been developed after the 28th week, wherein the retina gets sensitive to light. Now, all these things what I've just told you, it's very clearly mentioned in the Quran. It is mentioned in Surah Sajdah, chapter 32, verse number 9, he says, and it is he who has given you the gifts of hearing and sight and feeling and understanding. Moreover, it is mentioned in Surah Insan, chapter 76, verse number 2, he says, verily we have created man from a drop of mingled sperm in order to dry him, and we gave him the faculties, the gift of hearing and sight. And it is also mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 78, he says, that it is he who has given you the gift, who has given you the faculties of hearing and sight, and feeling and understanding. So little thanks, it is he we give. So as you can see, the verse that I just quoted to you, it clearly mentioned, it clearly describes that the first sense to be developed in a developing human embryo is the sense of hearing, then before the sense of sight. And if you compare this with the modern discovery that the embryologist has made, it fits perfectly without doubt. How can we all forget the fingerprint? It is mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Al-Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse 3 and 4. Does man think we cannot assemble his bones? Nay. We are able to put together in perfect order the very tips of his fingers. Unbelievers argue regarding resurrection taking place after the bones of dead people have disintegrated in the earth, and how each individual would be identified on the day of judgment. Almighty Allah answers that he can not only assemble our bones, but also can reconstruct perfectly our very fingertips. 1400 years ago, who could have ever known the uniqueness of each human's fingerprint? Surely, it could have been none other than the Creator himself.
To attribute the presence of scientific facts to coincidence would be against common sense and a true scientific approach. The scientific accuracy of the Quranic verses confirms the Quran's open declaration in the verse of Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse 53. Soon we will show them our signs in the furthest regions of the earth and in their own souls, until it becomes manifest to them that this is the truth. It is not enough that thy Lord doth witness all things. The Quran invites man to reflect on the creation of the universe in the verse of Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse 119. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ. Behold, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and in the alternation of day and night, there are indeed signs for men of understanding. The Quran, however, is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E, but it is a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. These signs invite man to realize the purpose of his existence in the earth and to live in harmony with nature. The Quran condemns such a closed mentality in the verse of Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 18. Summun bukmun umyun fahum la yarjiun. Deaf, dumb and blind, they will not return to the path. The Quran has a complete code of life for the individual and the society. Alhamdulillah, the Quranic way of life is far superior to the modern isms that man has created out of sheer ignorance. Who can give better guidance than the Creator himself? I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this humble effort, to whom I pray for mercy and guidance. Ameen. Jazakallah khair to all the panelists for sharing such great information, and I hope that the audience is more strongly affirmed that the Quran and modern science are indeed compatible. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.